Welcome to beautiful and yes, windy San Francisco, California. We are here to bring you the Brody File on location from beautiful San Francisco. And I must tell you, my goodness, is it windy out here? They say Chicago's the windy city. Forget about it. San Francisco's the windy city. Look, I know there's some conservatives and liberals who can't stand some of what I put up on the blog and put here on the show, but I can tell you right now that I'm sure you all hope that there's like a wind gust that takes me into San Francisco Bay. Oh. Hey, welcome everybody to the Brody File. This is gonna be a fun show. Why are we out in San Francisco? We're here because we interviewed Carly Fiorina. She's running for the U.S. Senate, of course, against Senator Barbara Boxer. We caught up with her in Sacramento, California, about an hour and a half north of here, and less windy, I might add. She talked about everything, the economy, the job situation. She even talked about her breast cancer, Sarah Palin and Mama Grizzlies, and of course, whether or not she's Senator Barbara Boxer's worst nightmare. Here's the interview.
Thanks so much for joining us. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Let me ask you, the polls, all right, Survey USA, everybody jumping for joy. I mean, look, you guys are ahead in the polls, and as I do a little deeper research inside those numbers, 49 to 32% among independents, what is going on? You are in a position to pull this thing off. What is your sense right now?
Well, the reason we can win here is because the people of California are worried about two issues, jobs and out-of-control government spending. And Barbara Boxer has a terrible record on both. She actually is running up and down the state saying that the stimulus bill is working, and yet our unemployment rate has gone from 10.2% when the stimulus bill passed to 12.3%. Mm-hmm. And people have seen in our own state what happens when government just gets bigger and bigger and taxes get higher and spending gets out of control. You bankrupt cities and states, and people are afraid we're going to bankrupt our nation. And they're tired of a government that's out of control and unaccountable. Mm.
Let me ask you point blank. Are you her worst nightmare?
Well,
for a lot of different reasons. Businesswoman?
I think, look, you'll have to ask Barbara Boxer that, but
she won't talk. She won't talk to me.
Here's what I think. Barbara Boxer has never been held accountable for her record. I will. Barbara Boxer has never faced someone who's actually created a job, met a payroll, and cut billions of dollars worth of spending. I have. Mm-hmm. Barbara Boxer cannot say to me that I do not understand the challenges that women face. And as you pointed out from the polls, the key voters here in California this time are swing voters. And swing voters know her, they don't much like her, and they're tired of her.
Sarah Palin endorsed you during the primary.
Yes.
She has all these mama grizzlies going around the country. Do you consider yourself one of those mama grizzlies?
Well, sure. You know, she endorsed me. I'm proud of that endorsement. I think, you know, one of the things that's so compelling about Governor Palin is the way she expresses things. So the phrase mama grizzly is very colorful, but it makes a point. And that is that there are all across the country men and women, but let's just talk about women for a moment, who are at a point in our lives where we're saying, you know what, we can make a difference here. Mm-hmm. And maybe the experiences that we've had will help restore some sanity in Washington, D.C.
Are you fully confident as to how your campaign is going, is being run?
The vast majority of our team signed on with me when I was still going through radiation. When I hadn't even made a formal announcement, when I didn't necessarily appear to be the obvious winner in a primary, much less someone who could beat Barbara Boxer. And so this is a team that has a lot of heart in this race, but they're also a team of just consummate professionals.
A year and a half since the surgery, how are you doing? Not just physically, but just, you know, how are you handling everything since that very tough time in your life?
Yeah. I feel fantastic. I am one of the lucky ones, you know. Someday I'll die, but it won't be a breast cancer. And you know, when I first was diagnosed, people told me that I would look back on it as a blessing. And I know that's such an odd thing to say, because I wouldn't wish it on anyone. It is a tough passage. But it has been a blessing. My family is stronger, my faith is stronger, I am stronger. And honestly, it puts things in perspective. I have a lot of heart for this fight, It's important. And nothing about this fight scares me after what I've been through.
The Prop 8 in California, I got to get you on. Give me your take on the fact that, you know, there are a lot of folks that say, look, 52% of Californians said yes to Prop 8, and here comes a judge walking along saying no deal. What is your take?
Well, the people of California have spoken very clearly on this issue. Fortunately, the decision by a single judge is the first in what will be a long, multi-step legal process. Mm-hmm. And I'm not a legal expert, but my opinion is it will end up in the Supreme Court. And I think the people of California believe their votes count.
The mosque, Ground Zero, with President Obama, has said he's injected himself into this. There's a lot of folks that feel like, you know, the issue is not, do they have the right to build it? That's never been the issue. But the issue really is more, there seems to be a disconnect with this president that he has not actually said, look, I don't think it's a good idea. We never heard that from this president. I mean, do you think he should say something like that, or should he have stayed out of it entirely?
Well, I think his comments were extremely unhelpful. And I think making this a matter of religious freedom is just wrong. Nobody disputes religious freedom in this country. And the people who are objecting to that mosque are not doing so on the grounds that people aren't free to practice their religion. They're doing so on the grounds that this is disrespectful to hallowed ground and to the families of victims of 9/11. And I think the families and their feelings are paramount in this issue.
The glass ceiling. You've broken the glass ceiling. We've heard this all the time. What kind of cuts and scrapes have you received from that glass ceiling?
You know, I don't like to talk in terms of the glass ceiling because I think it sends a message to women that there's this invisible barrier that's going to prevent them from achieving their dreams. This is America. While it's much different being a woman still, people can achieve their dreams here. But it is different for women still. It's different for people who are different. And I think it is still the case that women are subjected to perhaps a level of scrutiny and a level of criticism that men may not be. However, mm-hmm. the more women who run for office, yeah. the more women who are in positions of power and responsibility, the less and less we're going to see that.
Carly Fiorina here on the Brody File. As you know, we are here in San Francisco, the beautiful Golden Gate Bridge behind me. And I believe, just so you know, during that six and a half minute interview, my hairpiece actually fell off because of the wind. It is now floating somewhere. Is that right, Ian? Floating. Yes, Ian, can you give me the fuzzy wuzzy up? Yeah, confirming that it is floating in the San Francisco Bay. We do have multiple hairpieces here at the Brody File, a huge budget we have for the show.
You should now be ready for placement.
But back to serious matters, one of the big issues up here is, of course, gay marriage. And we talked to Randy Thomason, who's with SaveCalifornia.com. He's a big mover and shaker in the social conservative movement here in California. And he talked to me about Proposition 8, what the future is exactly for the situation up here, and also the moral implications.
If this was ancient Israel, God would send a prophet and tell the people to repent. That we get bad government and bad judges because the people are voting wrong or not voting at all and not caring according to God's standards. We have got evil Democrats and stupid Republicans who have put some awful judges on the bench, and we're getting the symptoms and the consequences of our spectator Christianity. It just doesn't work when it's done that way.
That was Randy Thomason. Now, just before we interviewed Randy, we actually spoke to a woman named Marilyn Miller. She is one of those 18,000 same-sex married couples who actually got married during the time that it was technically legal here in San Francisco. I had an interesting conversation about with her about this topic. She talks about being a Christian, and we explored that topic.
We are to promote love and not promote hate. And that's where I think the evangelical movement is off. You need to accept all people because we're all people of God. God created all of us, not just the few. And it's not about the hate and promoting against something. It's about promoting love.
You can imagine after Marilyn said that, it turned out Randy was actually listening. Randy Thomason was listening to that interview. Here's what he had to say in response to Marilyn.
For true believers, the word of God must be the judge. In Matthew 19, Jesus said, have you not heard that the Creator made them male and female. And for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So what God has brought together, let no man separate. That is Jesus defining marriage, the difference between male and female, and parenthood all in one fell swoop. Anyone who says that God does not call homosexuality a sin is tearing pages out of the Bible, and it's a story that they're making up.
Proposition 8, it really does not go away. As a matter of fact, many legal experts believe that we're not going to see this end for another 2 years or so. The U.S. Supreme Court obviously is expected to take this issue up, and they may not have a decision until the spring of 2012. All right, when we come back, we're going to do Faith and Politics from Windy. There goes my hairpiece again. That's number 4 in the bay. To Windy, San Francisco. Actually, we're going to come back and talk to Damon Dunn in our Faith and Politics segment. Who is Dave? Damon Dunn? That's a mouthful, by the way. Boy, I tell you what, he's got a great story from poverty to the NFL and now running for Secretary of State here in California. And he's a pastor, and he's got quite the story to tell. It's all about the resurgence of the GOP here in California. Will it happen? Damon Dunn could be part of the story. Back in a moment.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, ask yourself these 3 important questions. 1, does your company not offer dental insurance? 2, are you self-employed? 3, are you retired? If you answered yes to any of these, it's important that you call Encore Dental today. Encore Dental is real insurance, and your acceptance is guaranteed. You'll receive up to 100% coverage on preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures. Encore Dental can help you keep your teeth healthy, which may prevent infections that lead to heart disease and stroke. And with the high cost of procedures, it makes sense to have great coverage. Choose your level of benefits. There are no claim forms to fill out and no waiting for reimbursement. So go ahead, review it for 30 days.
Call 1-800-715-9148. Call now and save an additional 10%.
Call now and save an additional 10%.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
Welcome back to the Brody File here on location in beautiful and, as we have said, windy San Francisco. By the way, the Brody File, we are the San Francisco treat. No, just kidding. That's Rice-A-Roni. Hey, look, Faith and Politics now. It's time for our conversation with Damon Dunn. We spoke to him this past week in San Francisco. He's running for Secretary of State, African-American, conservative, preacher who has had a real tough life but has turned his life around. Born to a single mother in poverty, grew up in a trailer with a family of 10. It's quite the story. He ended up getting a scholarship to Stanford University and then made his way to the NFL. He's now out of the NFL. He's a multi-million dollar businessman now here in the Bay Area. We spoke to him about his story and what a remarkable situation he has found himself in.
My life story is certainly all about the American dream, that the individual can start where they are, use what they have, and do what they can until they, the individual, achieve the American dream. My mom had me at 16. My father was killed when I was 3. I lost 3 friends to murder by the time I was 16. I grew up 10 people, with 10 people living in a 3-bedroom trailer. And we ate, mayonnaise sandwiches. We were on food stamps, government cheese. We didn't have health care. So I grew up incredibly poor. But then I was able to go on to Stanford University. And I was able to ultimately go on and own my own small business and be very successful. And the lessons that I learned in my poverty are really what illuminates that experience. I learned that the government could be a safety net, but never a trampoline. That upward mobility would require the individual to create it, to develop it. The government was never going to spend me into middle class.
And where does God play in all of this? God has been such an important, integral factor in your life, and I want you to talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, growing up for me, I didn't have a lot of positive role models. You know, as I said, a couple of my uncles went to prison who I grew up with, and the only place where I found positive messages were at church. It was a place where I could be a part of a team. You know, I was an usher. I was also, you know, in the choir. And so I was a critical part of making a service happen on Sundays. And then I'd also hear the pastor talk about, you know what, just because you're poor and just because you don't have other resources that people that are wealthy that they have, you're just as valuable. And that made me feel good about myself. And the pastor was able to, growing up, you know, illuminate to me that the things that you do don't define who you are, but who you are define what you do. So I grew up with that inner peace of understanding that I'm not Damon Dunn, the football player, or Damon Dunn, the businessman. You know, I'm Damon Dunn, the child of God.
Damon Dunn here on the Brody File. All right, we're done for the time being from San Francisco. Let's send it back now to the studio, not as windy, but back to the studio and Jennifer Wishon, where I believe she has hairspray standing by. Jennifer, could you send some of that hairspray my way?
David, we are sprayed down and ready to go here in our nice wind-free studio. However, I can assure you, you definitely have a better view. You know, you were just talking about faith in politics, and here in the nation's capital, President Obama can't get away from it. According to a survey by the Pew Research Center, a growing number of Americans think the president is a Muslim. 18% think so. Just 34% of those surveyed think he's a Christian, despite the fact that Mr. Obama has told the public repeatedly that he is. Now a group of more than 70 Christian leaders have joined forces to say enough is enough. In a letter, they write, "We understand that these are contentious times, but the personal faith of our leaders should not be up for public debate. President Obama has been unwavering in confessing Christ as Lord and has spoken often about the importance of his Christian faith. Many of the signees on this letter have prayed and worshiped with this president." And for more on this problem for the president, including analysis, log on to the Brody File blog at cbnnews.com.
Still to come on this edition of the Brody File, counting down to the midterm elections, we'll take a look at the sizzling races in Florida and Arizona. Plus, oh my.
You can count on me to work for you.
A wannabe Senate candidate makes an interesting campaign commercial in his long shot race against an established senator. Will Brennan Barrett next?
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
Welcome back to the Brody File, where we're so far ahead of ourselves. We start the 2010 midterm elections part of the show talking about 2012. The man to watch this week, Mitt Romney. He's been hanging out with his old 2008 presidential campaign staff, raising money for the New Hampshire Republican Party. And over the next 2 months, Mitt has trips planned across 25 states. Romney will mostly be campaigning for 2010 candidates he's endorsed. Candidates up for election this November are coming into focus. We start in Arizona, where Republicans have demonstrated they're not ready for change. Senator John McCain easily won his primary against former Congressman J.D. Hayworth. Still, Hayworth forced McCain to jump to the ideological right and spend more than $20 million on his primary race. The big question now, will McCain stay to the right or will the maverick move back towards the middle? Time will tell. Meanwhile, McCain assures his supporters he's taking nothing for granted.
This will be a consequential election. No one should have any doubt about that. No one is satisfied with the current condition of our country. I know Arizonans, like Americans elsewhere, are rightly concerned with the direction we seem to be heading in.
The 73-year-old now faces 32-year-old Rodney Glassman, a Tuscan City councilman who won the Democratic primary. In Florida, the three-way Senate race is set. Democratic Congressman Kendrick Meek, Republican and Tea Party favorite Marco Rubio, and Republican-turned-independent Florida Governor Charlie Crist will square off in November.
I will be the only candidate, ladies and gentlemen, that's willing to pull back on the top 1% of the Bush tax cuts and give more tax cuts to the middle class and small businesses.
I am running for the U.S. Senate because I think Washington is wrong. I want to stand up to what they're offering, and I want to offer in its place a clear alternative.
This is an election about choice, and if we hadn't gone independent, they would have been locked in with one Democrat and one Republican and virtually no other choice besides that. The people always deserve a choice. That's why I'm excited to be running as an independent.
Now to the oy vey moment of the week, except since David Brody is in California, I'm replacing it with what I like to call the bless your heart moment. This time it comes to us from Vermont, where Daniel Freilich, the man who ran against Senator Patrick Leahy in the Democratic primary, recorded a web ad that's a spoof of an award-winning Old Spice commercial. That's right, folks, Old Spice.
Hello, Vermonters. Look here, Senator. Now back to me. Now back here, Senator. Now back to me. Sadly, he isn't me.
It certainly appears Mr. Freilich would add some spice to the Senate.
Look down. Back up. Where are you? You're in the 21st century with a candidate Vermont deserves.
What was he drinking? Was that maple syrup or a can of oil? I can't tell.
Anything is possible when your senator votes with his conscience and not his pocketbook. I'm Daniel Freilich, and I approve of this message. I'm on a couch. Yeah!
At first glance, it appears that Mr. Freilich is riding a stuffed animal, but take a closer look. That's a socked foot. It appears that's a person wearing a cow costume. Daniel Freilich, bless your heart. And your volunteer dressed up like a cow.
Now to this week's commentary. First Lady Michelle Obama has enjoyed high public approval ratings since her family moved into the White House. Quite frankly, the world can't get enough of her relaxed, elegant style. However, Mrs. Obama caught heat for her recent trip to Spain with daughter Sasha and some of her friends. She reportedly took the trip to spend time with a friend who's grieving the loss of a parent. And although she flew commercial and paid her own expenses, she, of course, had a team of Secret Service agents traveling with her on the taxpayer's dime. Critics say it was too expensive a trip during an economic downturn and that she shouldn't have gone to Spain before she and the president went to Florida's Gulf Coast to demonstrate there's no oil on the beach. Look, presidents and first ladies will often put off trips if they think their presence somewhere will divert resources away from an important mission. For instance, when Laura Bush delayed her much-anticipated trip to Afghanistan. But this was a vacation. The Obamas are independently wealthy, and it seems like the First Lady should be allowed to spend time with a special friend in need without worrying about taking a hit from the approval police. Well, stay with us. After the break, we're heading back to California, where David is leaving his mark as usual.
Pleasure. Great to see you.
Oh, that'll be on up on the blue.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
We're downtown today campaigning to save America's teeth because good dental health is about more than just brushing.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, call Encore Dental for affordable, quality dental coverage.
When was the last time you went to the dentist?
Like probably 3 years ago?
Probably back in college.
Poor oral health can lead to serious illnesses like heart disease and stroke.
What's your excuse?
It's just too expensive.
I'm self-employed.
No dental insurance?
None.
With Encore Dental, you can receive up to 100% coverage for preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures.
George retired a year ago.
You know, when I did, I lost my dental coverage.
There are no claim forms and no waiting for reimbursement. Call now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call 1-800-717-3124 now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call now and get an additional 10% off when you pay by credit card.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, ask yourself these three important questions. 1. Does your company not offer dental insurance? 2. Are you self-employed? 3. Are you retired? If you answered yes to any of these, it's important that you call Encore Dental today. Encore Dental is real insurance, and your acceptance is guaranteed. You'll receive up to 100% coverage on preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures. Encore Dental can help you keep your teeth healthy which may prevent infections that lead to heart disease and stroke. And with the high cost of procedures, it makes sense to have great coverage. Choose your level of benefits. There are no claim forms to fill out and no waiting for reimbursement. So go ahead, review it for 30 days.
Call 1-800-715-9148. Call now and save an additional 10%.
Call now and save an additional 10%.
And welcome back to San Francisco. Listen, before we leave you here, we just wanted to tell you a little bit about an interview that's coming up in a few weeks here on the Brody File. We're going to talk to Dr. Savage. That's right, not Fred Savage from the Wonder Years. No, no. You know who I'm talking about. Michael Savage, the radio talk show host who is based out here in San Francisco. Here's a little sneak peek of what you can see in a few weeks. This is where he just goes off on President Obama and the Ground Zero mosque controversy.
When you have Nancy Pelosi coming out and saying that she'd like to see a witch hunt, an investigation, she said it, not me, of those who oppose the mosque. Think about that. 70% of Americans oppose this mosque at Ground Zero. She would like a government investigation of the 70% of Americans who oppose the mosque. Where is the outcry from those who decried McCarthyism? Here is McCarthyism in a flying skirt. And there's not one word from the radical left saying, wait a minute, hold it. What do you mean investigate those who oppose the mosque?
Michael Savage here on the Brody File. That is just a small little sneak peek of what's to come in the next few weeks. That about does it from San Francisco. We really appreciate you joining me here. I'm going to be in the studio next week back in D.C. It won't be windy at all, we hope at least. We hope the air conditioning's working. My goodness, look at this wind. I'm off to Alcatraz where they're going to check me in room 43. And after that, of course, a beautiful time here in San Francisco, enjoying the San Francisco Bay, as you see there. I'll do a trolley ride. I'll eat some rice-a-roni. I may go to San Francisco City Hall and get married. Oh, no, just kidding. That's a joke. That's a little, you know, humor there. Listen, have a good one, and we'll see you next week in D.C.
You're watching CBN News Channel. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnewschannel.com.